in here, so it's the first time actually be able to do this. We'll try to work this out.
His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He is the mighty King, Master of everything. His name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord. He's the great Shepherd, the Rock of all ages, Almighty God is He. Bow down before Him, love and adore Him. His name is wonderful, Jesus, my Jesus is all the world to me, my life, my joy, my all. He is my strength from day to day, without Him I would fall. When I am sad, to Him I go, no other one can cheer me so. When I am sad, He makes me glad. He's my friend. Jesus is all the world to me. I want no better friend. I'll trust Him now, I'll trust Him when life's fleeting day shall end. Beautiful life with such a friend, beautiful life that has no end. Eternal joy. He's my friend. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord.
I want to thank you all for coming. I didn't realize how many people I owed money to. I'm going to ask if you'll open your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 5. Isaiah chapter 5, as you do, I'll only mention, you guys already know, the book table is out there. And I've often said you don't have to buy anything. You can just go buy and leave money if you'd like. But there is a, if I can get this out of here, there is a trifold pamphlet like that you might want to pick up. And I've often said that I am not of the bunker mentality. And by that I mean that if we are a military force for the Lord, the job of the military is not to dig a hole, climb in it, and defend it. And so I thought the job of the military was to take the enemy's ground away from him, right? And so if we are really a military organization, you know, I find in Christianity, I find a lot of folks, they kind of have what I call a bunker mentality, where they're just kind of, we're just trying to hang on to what we got until the Lord comes. You know, the devil's already won. And I don't subscribe to that, so I figure we ought to be able to to get some of the some ground that the devil has before the Lord comes back. And that's what those lessons are designed to do. I would get, I'd come into churches and I would have parents tell me all the time that they sent their son or daughter to a King James Bible-believing Bible college. And then when they got there, they heard that Easter didn't belong there, the italics were a mistake, King James homosexual. And go down through this whole list of things, and they came out not believing the book that they went in believing. And so there are two sets of lessons out there. This is that trifold tells you about both sets. The blue bordered set is the 11th grade. The red bordered set is the 12th grade. And those are compatible with ACE. There's 12. One stack is a year's curriculum. And that will give the answers before they get there and lose their Bible. All right? In other words, we're not raising anybody to go and cause a problem for any Bible college. But no more than the Bible college should cause trouble for the church, okay? Because I'm telling you, you know, pastors, they go and they send kids to believe the book and they are mocked. And those guys are sent home, and if they cause a problem in a church that believes the book, that Bible college has no sympathy whatsoever. So those lessons are out there. And everything else out there, you just peruse through it when you're done. All right, Isaiah chapter 5. Isaiah chapter 5. Something scary here in this verse. Verse 29, it says, "Their roaring shall be like a lion. They shall roar like young lions. Yea, they shall roar and lay hold of the prey and shall carry it away safe, and none shall deliver it." Let's bow our heads and let's talk to the Lord. Father, it is good to be saved. Lord God, thank you for salvation. Thank you, God, that it is free. Thank you, God, that it is complete. Thank you, God, for the confidence that we can have in Jesus Christ, Lord. We who have trusted you, Father, we gave up on ourselves, we gave up on our religion, and we trust only the death and the burial and the resurrection of Jesus Christ as the payment for our sins. God, some of the folks in this room tonight came a long way to be here. And I pray, God, that you'll bless every person. I pray, God, you'll bless them just for being here. And then also, God, maybe something the message, something in the message would also help them, Father, to live to your glory. God, bless your people that they will ultimately bless you. In Jesus Christ's name we ask it. Amen. Now, what I said about this verse being scary, it said they shall roar like lions.
They shall roar like young lions. They shall roar and lay hold of the prey and shall carry it away safe, and none shall deliver it. I don't know if you ever thought about what it'd be like to be eaten by a lion. It is not a pleasant thought. You know, what we don't realize is that a lot of what is eaten in the wild is eaten while it's still alive. Lions don't take people's pulse before they eat it. And so a roaring lioness, or this lion, we are told here to beware of this lion. I'm going to talk to you tonight about some lions that you need to beware of. There are some that, look, if I told you this, if you were parked 100 yards from this building, and I told you there might be a lion between here and your car, would you be careful when you left here? If you wouldn't be careful, I'm going to follow you. Because I figure if you're not careful, the lion gets you. While he's mauling you, I can get to my car. But then there are some lions that we need to beware of. I want you first to turn to 1 Peter chapter 5. 1 Peter chapter 5. And here is a lion. It says this in verse 8. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. Then the first lion that we need to be careful of tonight is the roaring lion. Now, the roaring lion, by the context, tells you the roaring lion is the devil. And the devil is the lion that will hunt you, okay? This lion is a hunter. As a rule, you know, we hear about man-eating lions. As a rule, lions in the wild are not man-eaters. As a rule, they will stay away from men. But here's the problem. They come, they discover two great truths. And those truths are that men taste good and run slow. And when lions find out that men taste good and run slow, brother, I mean, it's pure trouble, okay? There were a couple of lions over in Africa that, in the early 1800s, England was putting a railroad line across a portion of Africa, and there were a couple of lions that really got into that that workman's camp, and they would literally pick a man right out of the line while he was working on the railroad. They'd be laying the track, and one of those lions would come and just grab a guy, and off in the woods, off in the jungle, he would go. And by the time they found the guy, it was all over. In fact, they called those lions, they made a movie about it called, I think, The Ghost and the Darkness. How many of you have seen that movie? What are you doing going to movies? Compromising carnal people. Anyway, but they said that the workmen at night, because they didn't have any barbed wire, they would take a thorn hedge and they would put an entire thorn hedge all the way around the place where they slept. And they said that one of those lions, they would get down and low crawl through the thorns. Then they'd come up to a tent and they'd grab a hold of one of those workers and then using him like a battering ram, just blow right through that thorn hedge on the way back out in the jungle and just eat it. And those lions would hunt people. So it is the devil that will hunt you, okay? He's the one that's going to watch for you. He's the one that's going to roar, and you need to beware of the devil. Now, there's a verse in the Bible that tells us how to make the devil flee from us. What does the Bible say we have to do to make the devil flee from us? No. Somebody said resist him. I want you to look at James chapter 4. And in James chapter 4, the verse that you almost quoted says this in verse 7, submit yourselves therefore unto God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. I've never heard Christians, but that when you talk about getting the devil to leave them alone, they don't always quote the last half of that verse. They never quote the first half about submitting yourselves therefore to God. People, we are told to submit ourselves to God, then resist the devil, and he will flee from us. You know, here's the problem. you're at home, you know, and you get a knock on the door, and you go to the door, and there it's the devil. And you go, well, devil, what do you want? And he says, well, I want you to submit yourself to me. I want you to worship me, and I want you to let me run your life. And here's what most people will say. They'll say, oh, no, I can't do that because you might change the plans that I have for my life. You might make me do something I don't want to do. You might make me do something inconvenient. And so they send the devil on his way. Then there's another knock. at another door. They go to that door, and there's the Lord. And they say, well, Lord, what do you want? And he says, I want you to submit yourself to me. I want you to let me run your life. I want you to worship me. And you know what we tell him? We tell him the same thing. We say, well, you know, you might make me do something that's inconvenient. You might make me do something I don't want to do. You might change my plans for my life. Tell you what, why don't you just go away and I'll call you when the kid is sick. Now, the problem is that you're torn between two because, see, most Christians, we say, well, I don't want the devil to run my life. Most Christians don't want the devil to run their life, and they don't want God to run their life either. What they really want is the devil to leave them alone and God to be there whenever they need a fire escape. God is supposed to be there to be a helping hand, you know. You talk to people, they don't call him, they don't go to church, they aren't active for Christ, but as soon as there's a problem, they're going to get on the phone and God is supposed to jump off his throne and come down and help them. People, that's not going to happen. And so, on one side, the devil is bothering you. On the other side, God is bothering you. And I'm going to tell you, you're never going to have peace. And that roaring lion, one of these days, may get you. Now, the Bible said that if you want him to leave you alone, it says, submit yourselves, therefore, to God, then resist the devil. I can't get it clear down there. Oh, that's right. Then resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Now, let's just suppose something. This is total fiction. Let's just say that you have $20,000 in gold bullion. That gold bullion is at your home, in your bedroom, in the top drawer of your dresser, and that information was on the front page of this morning's newspaper. Now, if you had that money, and that's where you had it, I'll tell you something. You wouldn't be here right now. Right? Because you would be here, and everybody that gets the local paper would be in your bedroom right now fighting over the top dresser drawer to get the $20,000. The problem is that money is there, they know it's there, and they're going to come after it. Now, let's say you got that $20,000 in gold bullion, but here's what you do. You go down to the bank, and you get a, you know, you go to the sub basement, and you get a safety deposit box, and you put that $20,000 in gold bullion there. And that information was in today's paper. Now your house is safe, isn't it? You know why? What they want isn't there. They can't get what they want that you've got. And the reason the devil won't let some of you alone is because you've still got what he wants. You've still got your submission. You've still got your life. You still retain your worship for yourself. And here's what you need to do. Oh, devil, what do you want now? He said, I want the same thing I've always wanted. I want you to submit yourself to me. I want you to worship me and let me run your life. Is that what you want? Yeah, that's what I want. Could you wait right here? Lord, I submit myself to you. I worship you. I give you my life. It is totally yours. Hey, devil, you know that worship that you wanted? I just gave it to God. If you want it, why don't you go ask him for it? Where are you going? People, the reason the devil is always after you is because you still got what he wants. You're still retaining your life. You still refuse to give your worship either to God or the devil. And I get news for you. You're going to have to give it to one of them. My advice, submit yourselves therefore to God. Then resist the devil and he will flee from you. I want you to look at 1 Kings chapter 13. There's another lion to be aware of. It's found in 1 Kings chapter 13. Now you should know the story. Briefly in Israel's history, they were Baptist. You know they were Baptist because they had a split. If that's not a Baptist tradition, nothing is. And two tribes went with the king of Judah, and 10 tribes went with the... with Jeroboam, the king of Israel. And the king of Israel was afraid because even though he had the majority of the people, the location where Israel worshipped was Jerusalem, and that was still under control of Rehoboam, the king of Judah. And so what the king of Israel did, what Jeroboam did is he made two golden calves, and he put one in Bethel and one in Dan, and he told all Israel, come and worship at these calves. And God didn't appreciate that, so it says this, look at verse 1. 1 Kings chapter 13, verse 1. And behold, there came a man of God out of Judah by the word of the Lord unto Bethel. And Jeroboam stood by the altar to burn incense. And he cried against the altar in the word of the Lord and said, O altar, altar, thus saith the Lord, behold, a child shall be born unto the house of David, Josiah by name. And upon thee shall he offer the priests of the high places that burn incense upon thee, and men's bones shall be burnt upon thee. So God sends a man of God to curse this altar. And it does get cursed. And then this happens. Oh, let's see. Let's take a look at verse 4. When this happens, that gets the king upset. It said, it came to pass, when King Jeroboam heard the saying of the man of God, which had cried against the altar in Bethel, that he put forth his hand from the altar, saying, lay hold on him. And his hand, which he had put forth against him, dried up, so that he could not pull it in again to him. And here's what happens. King Jeroboam, when this man of God curses his altar, he says, lay hold on him. And as he does that, his arm dries up, and now it's frozen, and he can't bring it back. So he says this. Now, it's amazing. Here's an amazing thing. This guy will go after a man of God and consider him the enemy, but when he's got a problem, he's right there. That is not unlike 90% of the population of our country. I mean, I was telling you, the pastor, you know, they put us up in a campground. And we got up yesterday morning to go to church. And, boy, there were people lounging out in front of their trailers. And they were having campfires. And I'm not being critical of them. But I thought, all of these people, if you said, let's go to church today, they'd all say, well, this is my only day. And I don't have time. And there's too many hypocrites in the church. But as soon as their children or grandchildren are sick, they'd snap their fingers and think God's got to be there to take care of business. So here's this guy. He doesn't like what the man of God said. He says, lay hold on him. His hand shrivels up. And look what happens. Verse 6. And the king answered and said to the man of God, entreat now the face of the Lord thy God, and pray for me that my hand may be restored to me again. And the man of God besought the Lord, and the king's hand was restored him again, and became as it was before. So here it's like this. He says, get that guy, and his hand shrivels up, and he says to the man of God, he says, hey, will you pray for me that my one hand will be like my other one? And so he does, and all of a sudden he goes, well, that wasn't right. Make them both normal. And so he makes it, he healed his hand. Then he makes him an offer. Look what it says, verse 7. And the king said to the man of God, come home with me and refresh thyself, and I will give thee a reward. I don't know if anybody's ever promised you a reward, but I'll tell you, when a king offers a reward, I think you stand to do pretty well, don't you? I mean, I would think that a king would have some wealth to give. And he says, look, kid, you come home with me, and I'll make you rich. I will give you something. And here's the answer. Look at verse 8. And the man of God said unto the king, if thou wilt give me half thine house, I will not go in with thee. Neither will I eat bread nor drink water in this place. For so is it charged me by the word of the Lord, saying, eat no bread, nor drink water, nor turn again by the same way that thou camest. So he went another way and returned not by the way that he came to Bethel. Now here's what we find out. We find out that this man of God was told by God, go there, proclaim my judgment on that altar, and then when you leave, he said, don't eat food there, don't drink water, get out of Dodge, get out of town as fast as you can, don't even leave the same way you came, get out of town another way, but get out as fast as you can. Now things would have been good. Now think about this. Did this young man of God not know the will of God? He knew the will of God, didn't he? He knew exactly what the word of God was. He knew exactly what God wanted him to do. And then he is intercepted by an old man of God. Look at verse 11. Now there dwelt an old prophet in Bethel, and his sons came and told him all the works that the man of God had done that day in Bethel. The words which he had spoken unto the king, them they told also to their father. And their father said unto them, what way went he? For his sons had seen what way the man of God went, which came from Judah. And he said unto his sons, saddle me the ass. So they saddled him the ass, and he rode thereon, and went after the man of God, and found him sitting under an oak. And he said unto him, art thou the man of God that camest from Judah? And he said, I am. Then he said unto him, come home with me and eat bread. And he said, I may not return with thee, nor go in with thee, neither will I eat bread, nor drink water with thee in this place. For it was said to me by the word of the Lord, thou shalt eat no bread, nor drink water there, nor turn again to go by the way that thou camest. Again, notice, this guy knows where the Word of God is. He knows what the Word of God says. He knows exactly what he's supposed to do. Verse 18. He said unto him, I am a prophet also, as thou art. Now, the Bible says this guy was an old prophet, all right? And apparently, this guy was retired, and it doesn't sound like it's been voluntary. Sounds like God put him out to pasture for one reason or another. And you know what? When he found out that there was some action going on, he wanted to be in the middle of it. So he shows up, and he tells this kid, he wants to get this kid to come and eat with him so that he can tell everybody, you know, I had that man of God over for dinner last night. And the young man tells him, nope, I can't do it. God told me to get out of town. I can't eat or drink anything here. And watch what this guy does. Verse 18, he said to him, I am a prophet also as thou art. And an angel spake unto me by the word of the Lord, saying, bring him back with thee into thine house, that he may eat bread and drink water. But he lied unto him. Isn't it amazing that this young man knew where the Word of God was and what it said until an old man of God came in and gave him a new version of it?
Yeah, there you go.
I mean, how could an old man of God be wrong, right? I mean, you know, gray hair and white hair, and this has got a guy's been around preaching longer than I am old. Surely he must know what he's talking about. And when the kid got a new version, he got messed up. But here's the thing, people. Now think about this. Didn't the Lord tell this kid, don't stay there, get out of town? And this man of God said, an angel told him, you can come and eat with me. Well, in the divine scheme of things, does an angel trump God? No. So if God said do this, I don't care if an angel really did appear to this guy, that angel does not supersede God. But the young man of God trusted in the old man of God, got him a new version of the Word of God, and lost everything. Verse 19. So he went back with him and did eat bread in his house and drank water. It came to pass as they sat at the table that the word of the Lord came unto the prophet that brought him back. And he cried unto the man of God that came from Judah, saying, thus saith the Lord. Well, I wonder how many years it's been since that old man of God said, thus saith the Lord, and it was the Lord. But it was this time, wasn't it? Isn't it amazing that the very guy that got this guy disconnected from the Word of God and headed in the wrong direction was also the same guy that proclaimed his judgment? Thus saith the Lord, verse 21, for as much as thou hast disobeyed the mouth of the Lord and hast not kept the commandment which the Lord thy God commanded thee, but camest back and hast eaten bread and drunk waters in this in the place of the which the Lord did say to thee, eat no bread and drink no water, thy carcass shall not come unto the sepulchre of thy fathers. And it came to pass, after he had eaten bread, and after he had drunk, that he saddled for him the ass, to wit, for the prophet whom he had brought back. And when he was gone, a lion met him by the way, and slew him. Now the first lion we talked about was the roaring lion. This one is what I call the stalking lion. And here's the difference. The roaring lion will hunt you down. The stalking lion can only get you if you go where he dwells. In other words, this young man was taken around home, and that's where the stalking lion dwelt, and the lion got him. The stalking lion can get you if you frequent his territory. What that means, people, is stay away from sin. And here is the worst thing about it. The worst thing is that you may take a shortcut. You know, let's say you're going home one night and you're taking the long way home. You go, boy, I'd like to take a shortcut. And your buddy says, well, you don't want to take that shortcut because that goes right through the area where the lion lives. There's lions in there and they may get you. Here's the problem. You take the shortcut and the lion doesn't get you. You know what that does? That emboldens you to go through there again.
Yes, sir.
And emboldens you to go through again. And again, and again. And then one day we read in the paper that the lion got you. Let me tell you what happened. I was preaching at church one time. There was a lady in that church. When her husband was at work, the pastor would come by and spend 3 hours at that house. Now, I know what went through your mind, and that is natural. I'm not going to condemn you for that, but I'm going to tell you what they did for those 3 hours. They talked baseball. They said, oh, you believe that? Yes, I believe that. Yeah, we talked with that lady, and there was nothing ever went on in that house that was improper, except that they didn't abstain from the appearance of evil. Right? I mean, the guy across the street, I'll bet when he saw that preacher's car pull in the driveway, he said, uh-huh, I'll bet they're going there and there to talk baseball. But here's the danger in that. That man went into a situation that he shouldn't have been in, and nothing happened. Nothing bad happened. And he did it again, and again, and again. And finally, he stopped that. But here's the problem. You do that one time, two times, three, four, five, six, and all of a sudden, you end up in sin and go, how'd that happen? It happened when you disobeyed the scripture of not abstaining from the appearance of evil, and you went where the stalking lion dwelt, and this time it happened to be watching the pathway that you were on. So people, the best thing and the safest thing is to stay away from sin. You know where it is. Come on, man. You don't have to be led around by a hand. You say, sin, it's just out there. It's everywhere. It's not everywhere. Most of the time, you got to go where it is, and you go there voluntarily. And the problem is that you may go there voluntarily and come back and not be bothered. And you may go there and come back, and may go there and come back, and may go there and come back, and may go there and get slain by the stalking lion. So beware of the stalking lion. Don't go where sin dwells. Let's say this is true. Let's say there's a bar in town, and it's just got the best shrimp basket in town. Okay? I mean, shrimp basket's not sin. And let's say every Friday night you go in and you order that shrimp basket and you order a Diet Coke and you don't have a beer, you don't have any kind of a drink, any kind of hard liquor, and you go in that place and you go in there year after year after year and you say, look, I've been going in there for 15 years. Every Friday night I have a shrimp basket and a Diet Coke and I still haven't had a beer there. See, it hasn't hurt me at all. Let me tell you what's going to happen in 15 years' time. Your jokes are going to change. Your jokes will change. What you laugh at, it'll be different. What you say when you get mad, it'll be different. You can't put yourself in that environment day in and day out, week in and week out, month in and year out. You can't put yourself in that environment where somewhere, at some point, folks, the lion is going to get you. There's another one. I want you to look at 2 Kings chapter 17. 2 Kings chapter 17. And here's what has happened. The king of Assyria has conquered Israel. And when they conquered Israel, they took the Jews out of the land and dispersed them. Actually, what we read here in 2 Kings chapter 17 was an early form of genocide. They weren't killing the Jews, but they were trying to kill the Jewish culture. They took the Jews out and dispersed them amongst the heathen nations so that they would lose their Jewishness, and then brought heathen in and planted them and made settlements in the nation of Israel. But look what happens, verse 24. And the king of Assyria brought men from Babylon and from Cutha and from Ava and from Hamath and from Sepharvaim, and placed them in the cities of Samaria instead of the children of Israel, and they possessed Samaria and dwelt in the cities thereof. And so it was at the beginning of their dwelling there that they feared not the Lord. Therefore the Lord sent lions among them, which slew some of them. Now the problem here was that these people did not respect and worship the God of the land. Look what it says, verse 26. Therefore they spake to the king of Assyria, saying, the nations which thou hast removed and placed in the cities of Samaria know not the manner of the God of the land. Therefore he hath sent lions among them, and behold, they slay them, because they know not the manner of the God of the land. Then the king of Assyria commanded, saying, carry thither one of the priests whom you brought from thence, and let them go and dwell there, and let him teach them the manner of the God of the land. Look at verse 41. So these nations feared the Lord and served their graven images, both their children and their children's children. So did their fathers, and so do they unto this day. People, these lions were God's lions. All right? And you know when God sent lions in? He sent lions in when the people did not respect and worship the God of the land. Now, I got news for you. There are only two nations in history who have ever claimed this God as their God at their inception. That is Israel and the United States of America. Israel did not choose God. God chose Israel. And by the way, I still say Israel is God's chosen people. I'm not trying to steal their blessings. One of these days he's going to restore them. One of these days he's going to use them. I don't have any problem with that. Hey, there's enough verses in the Bible to bless me. I don't need to steal one from the Jews. But this nation, the one that you live in, at its inception chose the God of the land. Now, I was raised in public education. You know what that means? That means I was lied to 5 days a week. I was lied to 5 days a week. Let me tell you what I was told when I was in public school. I was told that this nation was not founded by Christians, that it was founded by a bunch of deists. Well, let me just read to you about some of the deists, so-called deists that were the founders of this nation. This is a prayer that George Washington, our first president, prayed. He prayed this: Almighty God, I beseech thee my sins, remove them from thy presence as far as the east is from the west. And accept of me for the merits of thy Son Jesus Christ, that when I come into thy temple and compass thine altar, my prayer may come before thee as incense. And as thou wouldst hear me calling upon thee in my prayers, so give me grace to hear thee calling upon me in thy word. For his sake, who lay down in the grave and rose again for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I'll tell you what you do. Go find a deist and ask him to pray. See if it sounds like that. I'll bet you he will not pray like that. Let me tell you what your second president said. John Adams said this: the Bible is the best book in the world. Do you know that if George W. Bush stood up and said that tomorrow, they'd be calling for his resignation? Second president of this nation said, the Bible is the best book in the world. Wait a minute. Why didn't they call for John Adams' resignation? Because everybody in this country at that time agreed with him. In fact, there's something else John Adams said. And what I'm going to do is, because I know you're raised on television, which means you don't think, I'm going to read you half of John Adams' quote. I'm going to let you finish it in your head, according to what Dan Rather and Tom Brokaw and Peter Jennings would have you think. Here's what the second president said. John Adams said, so suppose a nation in some distant region should take the Bible as their own law book, and every member should regulate his conduct by the precepts there exhibited. President John Adams said, suppose a nation took the Bible and everybody in that nation just lived by the Bible. Well, what would you have? Well, if you would believe the news media, you would have this bigoted and narrow-minded homophobic society. Here's what your second president said you would have. What a utopia, what a paradise this region would be. Here's what Thomas Jefferson said about the Bible. He said, the Bible makes the best people in the world. If you're wondering who that is, that's you. The best people on the face of the earth today are Americans. I'm telling you that for two reasons. One, because it's true. Number two, because nobody else is going to tell you. Everybody else is going to tell you that your deodorant's putting a hole in the ozone, and you're eating too much of the food, and you're breathing too much of the air, and everything bad that happens is America's fault. The best people on the face of the earth are Americans, and it is the Bible that made them that way. Thomas Jefferson said this: the Bible is the source of liberty. Well, I believe that, but think about it, guys. If the Bible is the source of liberty, then as the Bible is curtailed in our society, then our liberties are going to be restricted also. You know, like they may pass a law these days where you got to fasten your seatbelt. Here's what the sixth president said, John Quincy Adams. And I'm going to read you half of this one. I'll let you finish it according to the news media. Here's what he thought the greatest thing of the American Revolution was. He said, the highest glory of the American Revolution was this. Well, was what? Well, it was free enterprise. Pizza Hut. Well, that's what they'd have us think. You know, when the Berlin Wall came down and communism went belly up in Eastern Europe, we lied to those poor people because we told them they wanted to be like us, and we told them it was free enterprise that made this nation great. It was not free enterprise that made this nation great. It is this book and the God of this book that made this nation great. Here's what your sixth president said. The highest glory of the American Revolution was this, that it connected in one indissoluble bond the principles of civil government with the principles of Christianity. Your sixth president believed that the greatest thing about the revolution was that civil government and the Bible were going now hand in hand. Hey, our country wasn't forming its own religion, but our country was based on the God of this book. We did not come here. Listen, the pilgrims did not come over here and get off the Mayflower so they could open up a 7-Eleven or a Burger King. You understand? You say, well, how did we get free enterprise? Real easy. Same way you get diesel fuel. You know how you get diesel fuel? You know there's not a refinery in the world that was built to make diesel fuel. They all make diesel fuel. They were built to take crude oil and make high-test gasoline. And if you will take crude oil and make high-test gasoline, you will have a byproduct called diesel fuel. And if you will found a nation on this book and the God of this book, you will have a byproduct called freedom and free enterprise and liberty. Let me give you a couple more here because this is good. Here's what the House Judiciary Committee said May 27th, 1854. You ever hear that song, I was there when it happened, so I ought to know? Well, they were a little bit closer to the ink just being dried on the Constitution than the nine bozos they have in Washington right now. So they might know a little more about the Constitution than those guys do. Here's what they said. Had the people during the revolution had any suspicion of an attempt to war against Christianity, that revolution would have been strangled in its cradle. At the time of the adoption of the Constitution and its amendments, the universal sentiment was that Christianity should be encouraged. That was the religion of the founders of the Republic, and they expected it to remain the religion of their descendants. Nobody came over here to found a multicultural society. That is a fiction that was made up by public education and the news media. You say, well, are you saying people of other faiths aren't welcome here? They're all welcome here. They're all welcome to come here. But when they get off the plane, you pick that scab off your forehead and you get down on your hands and knees and trust Jesus Christ, your personal Savior, and join up. And if you want a Muslim country, there are plenty to choose from. And if you want a Hindu country, there are plenty to choose from. And if you want a Christian nation, I got news for you. You can't find two of them on the face of the earth. This is the only one. What's the greatest thing that Patrick Henry ever said? No. I know. Give me liberty or give me death. Oh, that's not. You only say that because that's the only thing you know that he said, right? You don't even know a second thing that he said. I think that's the second greatest thing that he said. The greatest thing that Patrick Henry said was this. I like the thick crust with pepperoni and a little mushroom. Oh, no, I'm sorry. Right here. This right. He said, it cannot be emphasized too strongly or too often that this great nation was founded not by religionists, but by Christians, not on religions, but on the gospel of Jesus Christ. He was there when it happened. He ought to know. Here's one last one from that Christian publication, Newsweek magazine. And this was in an article that they published December 27th of 1982, entitled, How the Bible Made America. For centuries, the Bible has exerted an unrivaled influence on American culture, politics, and social life. Now, historians are discovering that the Bible, perhaps even more than the Constitution, is our founding document. Guys, this is not a King James Bible thumper that said this. This is an anti-Christian publication that hates the Bible and hates this country and couldn't deny that much of our history. Now, guys, they just said that even more than the Constitution, this book is the foundation that this nation was based on. But if the foundation be destroyed, what can the righteous do? Bible study was the core of public education. Well, how's that for separation of church and state? Bible study was the core of public education, and nearly every literate family not only owned a Bible, but read it regularly and reverently. You like that? Well, I got bad news for you. If you have a Bible and you're not reading it, the early Americans would think you're what's wrong with this country. I mean, they had one and read it. They didn't just have it on the coffee table where they could smash the first rose from the first date that they ever had. The whole family read the Bible together. And here we are, Bible believers, claiming to love the book and believe the book, and we don't read the book that we say we believe. If the founding fathers could see us, they'd say, "You believe the Bible?" "Yeah." "How often do you read it?" We go, "Oh, we don't read it." "So I thought you believed it." Because of this biblical influence, the United States seemed to Europeans to be one vast public congregation, a nation with the soul of a church. People, our founding fathers, in essence, sat around a table, and I've been at that table in Philadelphia, where they wrote the Constitution and ratified it, and they sat around that table, and on July 4, 1776, basically they said this. They said, we're going to found a new nation. And then corporately they looked toward heaven and said, "And we want you to be our God." This is the only nation in history that chose the God of the Bible at its inception. I told you, Israel is God's chosen people. God chose them. They didn't choose God. We chose God. You say, "Well, did that excite God?" Did that excite God? Hey, he let those 13 colonies take on the mightiest military of the world, England, and whip them. Do you understand, people, that when our colonies went to war against England during our revolution, that was the equivalent of Haiti declaring war in the United States? I mean, if you picked up the paper tomorrow and it said, "Haiti declares war on America," and then you see they're really getting down to business, look, it says they're inflating their navy right now.
He had us whip them again. God has blessed this country. I'm going to tell you, the God of this land, the God of the United States of America, is the God of this book. This is not a multicultural country, never was intended to be, not by God, not by the founders, and no one has the right to change our history. And you don't respect the manner of the God of the land, and he'll send... They may have names like Isabel, or Hugo, or St. Helens. They may come in the form of two airplanes in two towers in New York City. See, I don't believe at all that was the judgment of God. I think that's God just saying, "This is my country, guys. You better wake up." I think every time, listen, I mean, you understand, we have a country now where at one end of it we're having floods, and at the other end of it we're having fires. We have earthquakes, we have a volcano go off, we have hurricanes come through, and tornadoes. You say, "Oh, you think God is judging America?" No, sir, I do not think God is judging America. Because when God judges a country, it is never business as usual. If God had judged this country, you wouldn't be here tonight. You'd be sitting in your house right now in your living room with a shotgun in your hand, scared death somebody's going to break in and kill you and take your food. No, he has not judged this country yet. In fact, he's even taken up the side of those who stood against us. But the fact is this, people, he will send lions when we don't respect the God of this land. Well, there's two more. I want you to go to Ezekiel chapter 19, and I'll show you a horribly dangerous lion. Ezekiel chapter 19. And it says this, verse 1. "Moreover, take thou up a lamentation for the princes of Israel, and say, What is thy mother? A lioness. She lay down among the lions. She nourished her whelps among the young lions. And she brought up one of her whelps. It became a young lion, and it learned to catch the prey, and it devoured men." You know what lion that is? You. I know I'm looking at a room full of humans, but... You know, I preached for over 30 years, and you would be amazed how many humans can turn into lions. You say, "Well, what does it take?" It usually takes having a preacher get them good and mad. And a preacher makes them mad, and you know what they decide? It is time for God to call them somewhere else. And so they learn to catch the prey, and they devour men. You get in I say that in independent Baptist churches,
You get a lion in there, and that lion knows how to get people gathered to him. That lion knows how to get a new member. You know, come on over to my house for supper. You know, we're really glad here. We love our pastor, but we're just concerned about this one little problem here. You know what it is? They learn to catch the prey, and they devour men. Now, here is the problem, people. If you ever was raised on a farm, when a dog finds out what's inside them eggs, you may as well shoot him. He'll never be good again. He'll go after eggs every time. And when a lion in Africa, like I said, discovers that men taste good and run slow, I mean, come on, guys. Why chase something with four legs when you can get something in half the time that's only got two? And when a Christian becomes a lion, they devour men and devour men and devour men and devour men and devour men. Years ago, when I was pastoring up in Auburn, I had this preacher come in, and he brought a guy with him, and you know who this guy was? He's a millionaire. What preacher doesn't want to know a millionaire? I mean, we got the ideas and they got the money. What a team. That's how we think. Yeah, that's how preachers think. I talked to a pastor one time. He said, he was bemoaning this. He said, "Where's my millionaire?" I said, "What?" He said, "So-and-so," he mentioned another pastor that had a church that had a millionaire. He said, "He's got his millionaire. Why don't I have my millionaire?" "Well, I've been looking for mine for a long time. In fact, I'm looking for two $500,000 heirs. Or I'm looking for $1,000,001 heirs, okay? Maybe you could join in there." But now let me tell you, this millionaire, he's a good man. He was a good man. He lived in a large city. And that city had no King James Bible-believing church. And here was this man's problem. He had a complaint. He had a legitimate complaint. Pastors fleeced him all the time. They fleeced him all the time. When they found out he had money, they had a project. They told him how God was in this, and they'd get this money out of him and that money out of him. And we're sitting down at lunch, the three of us, and he's telling me, he's not bitter. He is not bitter, but he's just getting tired of being taken. But in this conversation, he also said this. He desperately wanted a Bible-believing church in his city. And he said, "I would be willing to rent a house, rent a building, pay the pastor a salary to get a church going." And I said, "When do you want me there?" No. Anyway, and as we talked, I said this. I said, "Brother, let me tell you something." I said, "First off, let me say this. You seem to think that some guys have taken advantage of you because of your money. I believe you're right. I said, I believe that you have been taken advantage of. I said, I believe some guys have done you wrong. Okay, I said, I believe that. I said, but here is the danger that I see. I said, the danger that you are in right now is you are in the danger of becoming what we in the ministry call unpastorable. You know what unpastorable is? You guys are pastors, know what that is. That's a guy who gets one notch up from a pastor and is never lower than a preacher again. And that guy will eat up a pastor and eat up the next one and eat up the next one and eat up the next one. And I said, here's the danger. I said, you are in danger of getting some young man in there to start a church, and then the first time he makes you mad, you're going to kill him. And I know that you think I'm trying to protect a preacher by keeping you from killing him, but I'm not. I'm trying to protect you. You see, people, here's what I've learned in the ministry. Murder is a bad habit. The tough one is the first one. That's when you discover what's in the egg. That's when you find out men run slow and taste good. And once you kill the first one, it gets easy. You know, that millionaire got him a young preacher. He rented him a place to live. He rented a building. They started church. And I mean, that church took off like a hot air balloon. It went straight up. It just grew and grew and grew. I had several meetings in that church over a number of years. And I had a meeting in that church one time. I was there for a week. And there was something wrong. And I finished up that meeting. The pastor didn't tell me any problems in the church or anything like that. But I'm leaving town with my wife, and I said this. I said, "Gipper," I said, "this church has a problem, and this meeting did not help it." I said, "Inside of 6 months, that church is going to split." I said, "I don't know why, But the Spirit was there, and I said, I'd like to think that my meeting helped, but it didn't help. That church split 3 months later. You know what the problem was? That preacher had made Daddy Warbucks mad. And boy, Daddy Warbucks had become a lion. And he had learned to catch the prey, and he was devouring men. He ran that preacher out of the pulpit. They got a new pastor. That guy didn't last 1 year. Before the year was out, that guy would be preaching, and Mr. Moneybags would be sitting in the congregation heckling him. Literally, out loud, interrupting his service, heckling him. Ran that guy out. This time, he put his cousin in the pulpit because blood's thicker than water, and that still didn't work, and he ran him out. You say, that man was wicked. That man was a good man. That millionaire was a good man. That was a man that wanted to serve the Lord. He had a means with which to do it, but I'll tell you what happened. He got displeased, and he learned to catch the prey, and he devoured men, and he became a lion. And don't you worry about him. Here's the problem. There isn't one person in this room that is not susceptible to the very same thing. You think that that guy is so wicked, and I'm telling his twin is in this room tonight. And if you want to know what they look like, hit one of the restrooms before you leave and stand at the sink and look in the mirror. Oh, I'd never do that. You wouldn't do it tonight. Because tonight you're not mad at anybody. You say, well, that's what they do. They do that to preachers all the time. Preachers do that to preachers. Preachers hurt preachers. Preachers hurt other Christians that displease them. The danger is not what a pastor is going to do to a church member or what a church member is going to do to a pastor. The danger is that when we are displeased with somebody, we find a way to get them. That's a lie. And the worst part about it is you'll never do it once. Once you find out how easy this is, once you find out how slow they run, once you find out how good they taste, you'll be eating them all the time. There is one more lion. I'll let you go. I want you to go to Proverbs chapter 22. Proverbs chapter 22. You should have read this proverb today. And we're going to look at Proverbs 22 and Proverbs 26. Proverbs chapter 22 says this, verse 13. The slothful man saith, there is a lion without, I shall be slain in the streets. Look at Proverbs 26, same verse, verse 13. The slothful man saith, there is a lion in the way, a lion is in the streets. You know what this lion is? This is an imaginary lion. This lion doesn't exist anywhere but between the ears of a slothful person. The slothful man didn't say it. Now look, guys. If there is a lion standing in your front yard, looking you right in the eye and roaring, you're a fool to walk outside. But you know, the slothful man never quite sees that lion, but he knows it's there. I mean, you call him up and say, hey, you didn't go to work today. So, man, there's a lion stalking right around outside my house. Are you kidding? Yeah. Did you see him? Yeah, I saw him. Well, I didn't see him. I mean, I saw the bushes moving where he was walking through there, though. I know that was him. And I was out there last night. I could hear something out there. I know there was a lion out there. You ever been in the woods at night? Oh, man, you want to talk about sound being magnified. Brother, you can hear yourself thinking. Well, some of you couldn't. The slothful man doesn't do anything. He just stays on the couch and practices for the remote Olympics. And you ask him why he isn't doing anything for God, and you know what he'll say? Well, there's a lion out there. You never found a slothful man that's going to say, I'm slothful. Oh, aren't you serving God? I'm too lazy. Oh, no, he's always got a good excuse. And it's always a lion. Preacher says, we need to build. So he says, oh man, as soon as we, don't you know the Lord's coming back and there's no sense in starting it now. That's a lion. That's a lion. You wouldn't believe how much work for God has not been started because of that lion. How many guys have not gotten to Bible college? I talked to a guy today. He called me on the phone. He's been eat up, man, for
almost 20 years since the Lord called him to preach, and he hadn't obeyed. He told me that. He said, what do you think? I said, I would get to Bible college as quickly as I can. He said, well, the Lord's coming pretty soon. I said, drive fast. I wonder how many people in this room the Lord has told you to do something. And just before you did it, you thought you heard the roar of a lion. And you said, well, there's no sense in starting. Well, I don't want to do that, man. A lion will get me. And people, all the time, there's an imaginary lion. Boy, if you do that, you're going to have trouble. Oh, if you do that, this will be a problem. Oh, you better not do that. Let me tell you what happened. I was talking to a pastor in Yuma, Arizona. And then there's a Marine base in Yuma, Arizona. And this pastor, he wasn't in the Marines. He was in the Navy, but he was a Marine corpsman. He was a corpsman for the Navy corpsman for the Marines. And he wanted to have a chapel service on that Marine base. The problem was that he had to get the chaplain's permission, and the chaplain was a Roman Catholic. Well, there's no sense in even trying. That's a lion. But you know what he did? He went in to talk to this Roman Catholic, and he thought, well, I know he's going to say no, but I'm going to give it a shot. So he says, I went in there, and he said, as I'm talking to this guy says, you look familiar. And he thought, oh no. He knew where he'd seen him. This Catholic priest says, haven't I seen you preaching on the street? He thought, oh no, he's heard me out there screaming, the Pope is a dope. He said, we preach on the street. This Catholic priest said, boy, we need that around here. He said, I'll tell you what, I want you to have a chapel service every Wednesday with these men. And if you'll bring me some flyers from your church, I'll pass them around the base to get people interested in coming. Yeah, but you see, he only found that out because he went out and tried. I wonder how many preachers have said, yeah, there's a base in our town, but there's no sense in trying because there's a lion for a chaplain. And if I go out there, it'll just never happen. It'll never work. People, time and again, I see opportunities for Christians to do something. And we will say, well, the Lord's coming back. There's no sense starting. Oh, there's no way we can do that. Oh, we'll never be able to do this. Let me tell you what we're doing. I have a burden. I told you, I want new ground, okay? I want new ground. I don't want to hold what we got. I want to get ground that the devil has now, and I want to have it in possession of God's people before the Lord gets back. I don't mind writing King James Bible believing books for King James Bible believers to buy and put on their shelf next to all their other King James Bible believing books. I don't have any problem with that. I don't mind that. But that's not new ground. I want new ground. I got a list in the... Oh, right here. I have a list that I know of, 8 different churches that through the answer book have been converted to the King James Bible. That's new ground. That's new ground. I was out in California and a family came and they said this. They said, we didn't believe the King James Bible is the Word of God. We went to your website to disprove it and got converted to the King James Bible. Well, here's what I want to do. I want to get the books that King James Bible believers write on mainstream Christian bookstore shelves. Because that's the only way you're going to get new ground. But the problem is this. The problem is that every King James Bible author is his own publisher. We're all a one-man show. And a bookstore won't deal with a one-man show. So I'm starting a publishing company that'll publish the books of multiple authors. And I don't care if a bookstore doesn't buy my books. Let them buy some other guy's book and let somebody buy that book and discover the King James Bible issue. Now, I've been working on that for 4 years. You say, why so long? Because I live on the road. And what takes a month on a house takes about a year on the road. And as I've thought about this, I've tried to cover from every angle, and I can see two things where this thing may come apart.
It may come apart because I'm going to find out that it is just more than I can take and still do everything I'm doing right now, which means it'll break me. Okay, so maybe it will, maybe it won't. We'll find out. The second one is it'll break me financially. And I've thought about this, and I'll tell you where it's going to be expensive. The expense is going to be in advertising books. Believe it or not, that's going to be the expense. So this is either going to, we're going to do one of two things, one of three things. We're either going to break Sam Gipp financially, break him physically, or succeed. We could succeed. Right? You know what I'd like? I'd like some preacher's wife. This guy uses the NIV. He doesn't even know why they gave it to him in Bible college. And his wife goes into the local Christian bookstore to get her new Christian rock CD. And while she's there, she sees some book on 2 Timothy and thinks, oh, my husband said he's going to be teaching on 2 Timothy. I'll just buy this for him. And that thing was written by a King James Bible believer. And she hands it to him. And he's sitting in his study one night and goes, whoa, I'm using the wrong Bible. That's new ground. I'll tell you what'll stop us. I'll tell you what won't stop me. Now look, it may break me financially. It may break me physically. That'll stop me. But it won't be an imaginary lion. I'm not going to sit around going, oh, better not try. Oh, there's no sense in trying. You can't do that. You know how many times I've heard people say, you can't do that? How many times have you said it? Well, you can't do that. That's a lion. More work has been stopped from ever being started for the Lord by a lion that doesn't even exist. You know what's going to happen one of these days? The Lord's going to come back. He's going to come back and he's going to haul us out of here. And the slothful man, you know what he's going to do as he's going up? He's going to look back, see what that lion looked like. Let me tell you what happened. I was out in Kansas. And I'm a car nut, you know. And this pastor had this old 50 Chevy pickup truck. It was a shambles. It was in pieces. And he was going to restore it, and he was showing it to me. And I just wasn't thinking. It just never entered my mind of any danger. He's got this thing. I mean, the engine's out of it. It's just a frame and a cab on there, and the fenders are laying here, and the hood's over there, and the bed's back over there. But the cab is still in one piece. And I grabbed the driver's door, and I was just going to open the door and climb up inside of it. So I open up the door and step to get in it, and right on the floorboard is a coiled up rattlesnake. I mean, right there, facing the door. You say, what'd you do? I didn't do a thing. I wasn't scared. Honest, I was not afraid. I didn't run, I didn't jump, I didn't yell. I just looked at it and saw it. You know why? It was a skeleton. That rattlesnake had crawled up in that truck sometime, who knows how long earlier, coiled itself up and died and rotted, and all that was left was that skeleton. And as much as I don't like snakes, even I'm not afraid of a skeleton. You know what's going to happen to the slothful man? The Lord's going to come back and he's going to say, I'm going to see where that lion was. I think he was right behind that bush right there. And you know what they're going to see? They're going to see bleached white bones of something that died 25 years earlier. I wonder how many people are going to do nothing for God because of a lion that they thought was outside their door. They wouldn't go out and do anything because there was a lion there and that lion would get them. I'm going to tell you this and I'm going to be done. I knew a guy. This guy graduated from a Bible college and he really sought to serve the Lord. The guy's heart had always been to serve the Lord. He just couldn't seem to get it together. He just really could not seem to get it together. He took a church and that did not work. So he went to another town and another state and started a church and that fell on its face. So he fell back on the who can fail at this plan and became a street preacher and failed at that. Now this is all going on over about a 6, 7, 8, 9 year period of time. He's a good man. He's just finding new ways to fail in the ministry. And one day he said this, God's called me to be a missionary. And I thought, oh great, now he can go where he can starve to death. I mean, at least over here he's going to have friends and family. He's going to go to some foreign field and he'll really fail. And that guy went to the mission field 25 years ago. And he is one of the best missionaries out there. And for all I know, some of your churches may support him. Wouldn't it be something if after failing in the ministry, failing at the pastorate, failing at the starting a church, failing at street preaching, if he had, Lord said, go to the mission field, and he'd have said, I'll just fail again. And that lion had kept him from going out to the mission field. I get a friend of mine. His name's Ken McDonald. You can ask Ken about this. He's an evangelist. And Ken, I had a meeting with a church, in a church that he had, and he had started. It didn't work. And I think he went to help another guy, and that didn't work. And I think he went and pastored another church for a while, and that didn't work. And I think he started another church, and that didn't work. I mean, he was in about 3 or 4 churches. It just didn't work. And one day he's talking to me, he says, Sam, he said, I think God wants me in evangelism. I said, do you like to eat? I said, Ken, you'll starve to death. I did. I gave him the advice. I said, whatever you do, don't go into evangelism. I am here to tell you, I've never been so glad I'm wrong in all my life. Ken McDonald's one of the best evangelists in this country. He is one of the finest men you'll ever meet. One of the greatest preachers. I have never been in a church where Ken McDonald had been there, but that either the pastor or some member of that church didn't say, Ken McDonald helped us. But wouldn't it have been easy for him to say, well, no sense in going out there. A lion will get me. Of all the lions, people, of all the lions, this is the worst one. Because it only exists in our head. It feeds on our fear, and it keeps us from doing anything for God. And we need to beware of those lions. I'd like you to stand with your heads bowed. Your heads bowed. What lion do you need to beware of tonight? Oh, it may be the roaring lion. It may be. I don't know that the devil messes with near as many people as they think. But I can tell you this, it's always safe and it's always good to submit yourself to God. So if at all you feel like the devil is on your case, just submit yourself to God, resist the devil, and he'll flee from you. What about the stalking lion? I wonder if there's somebody who's just crossing into the territory where a lion lives, and you went there and got back, and everything was okay, and you went there and got back. And you say, well, I've gone there several times. Nothing happened to me. Well, you and the lion just weren't there at the same time. But you go where sin dwells, and the lion may get you. I wonder if you'd think about our country. People, the God of this Bible is the God of this nation. That He is the God of our land. And we really need to do everything we can to turn Americans. You know what America is? Really, America. That quote from Newsweek was, it was a nation with the soul of a church. America is one big, big backslidden family. And they just need directed to come back home. What about the lion that becomes the predator and preys on the sheep? Oh, now wait a second. I know you're standing there right now and you're thinking of somebody else. Quit thinking of somebody else. Oh, yeah, I know, preacher. I know somebody who's a lion. Quit thinking about them. That's not the danger. The danger is you becoming one. You ever get on the telephone and start talking about another Christian? Oh, I know, you were justified. Yeah, you were justified in what you said. Every lion that ever killed anybody said the same thing. Every lion that ever killed anyone, every Christian that ever split a church or badmouthed another Christian, ripped the throat out of somebody, every single one of them said, I was right. Don't become a lion. And whatever you do, don't become a slothful man or a slothful woman that does nothing for God because of a lion that doesn't exist anywhere but between your ears. I'm going to ask the pastor's daughter to come to the piano in just a moment. I'm going to have a word of prayer. And we're going to give an invitation. You say, what's the invitation? Well, you tell me. What lion is it tonight that maybe you felt brushed by you while I was preaching? What lion is it tonight that is a danger to you and to your service for Christ? Maybe it's time to make sure you don't become one. Maybe it's time to make sure you don't become the victim of one. Maybe you better be sure there's even one out there in the first place. Don't let an imaginary lion keep you from doing anything for God. Father, I thank you for your goodness. I thank you for your grace. I thank you for your great kindness. God, I thank you for protection from the one lion that can hurt us the worst, the roaring lion. God, I submit myself to you tonight. I pray, God, every person here will just surrender themselves completely to you, that they'll hold nothing back, that they will submit themselves to you, then resist the devil, and we know he'll flee from them. And God, I pray that all of these lions that I've talked about tonight will be avoided by the people in this room. That God, we won't become one, that we won't see to it that Christians become our victims, that our words are used to hurt churches and ministries and individuals. And God, I pray that we'll not be afraid of a lion that doesn't even exist. God, help our people, please, to avoid these lions. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed, as the piano plays, if the Lord has dealt with you about something, now's the time. Will you come?